Well, before we start our presentation, may know how many of you have basic understanding of reinforcement learning? Anyone in the room? Oh, couple of hands. Okay. So remember these people, if you have any question on RL, either you come to us, anyone of us, or you reach out to your nearest friends. Okay. So I feel many of you have no understanding of reinforcement learning, but it's absolutely fine. Whatever prerequisites are required for this talk, we'll cover all of those. Okay. But my request to all of you, pay at most attention at each and every detail, because if you lose the flow in the middle, it will be very difficult for you to come back on track. Okay. And towards the end of this presentation, we'll have a question and answer session only for 5 minutes. Okay. Fine, with no more delay, let's begin our today's session on deep reinforcement learning. Now, Samiran will continue from here.
Hello everyone, thank you for coming. So I'm also a senior lead data scientist at Investment Globally, and let's just jump right into the problem. So you have this 3D simulated robot in your computer, and you can control this robot by applying a small force or a torque to each of its joints. So theoretically, this robot was built in such a way that it can perform a wide variety of very complicated physical motions. But initially, this robot does not know how to do anything. It is just doing something randomly. And the only thing it is doing is like falling spectacularly from all of these positions. The idea is that you show this robot a video of this person doing a motion called a cartwheel. And you tell this robot, I'm going to reward you every time you follow the motion of the human in the video. So this robot is a very selfish robot. So it wants to do all it can to maximize its rewards. So you go away, you go somewhere, you come back, and this is the picture you will see. So it's trying to do something which looks like a cartwheel, but it's not able to nail its landing properly. So you give it some time to improve itself. So after a while, this is the picture you see. It has successfully learned how to do a cartwheel. So naturally, the next question you will ask is, okay, if I show it another video, will it be able to learn from that? So the answer is, yes, in fact, you can show it any arbitrary video and it will be able to learn how to do that task. So this work was done by the AI research lab at UC Berkeley, and the goal of our presentation is to break down algorithms that can do this kind of learning. You must have guessed that we are talking about something called reinforcement learning, or RL. So RL is typically used in conditions where you have to make a sequence of decisions. So typically you have some kind of agent. So this agent can be a robot or a self-driving car or even a chess playing bot, and it's in some environment. The agent senses the state of the environment and does some thinking. Based on that thinking, it takes an action. So this action can be move your arm up or go to some place or maybe make this move in chess. But the key thing to note about this action is that it influences the state of the environment the agent is in, and also it influences the future actions this agent might take. So many real life problems have the same flavor. Think about driving a car when you are constantly reacting to some kind of dynamic environment. And if you bump into someone, you are definitely changing the state of the environment. Similarly, if you take a wrong action and go slightly off a road, you'll need to devote some future actions to come back into the road, right? So we have this sense, think, and act cycle. What do we do with it? We want this agent to learn some kind of task. And the way to do that through reinforcement learning is you reward the agent for good behavior. But maybe you can also penalize the agent for bad behavior and let the agent figure out the best actions in order to maximize these rewards. So think of how a baby learns how to walk. So it will get up, it will try and do something. Maybe at some point it will swerve a little bit too much towards the left and fall down, right? So the pain from falling down serves as negative reinforcement to the baby, never to take that to action again. And similarly, if you have the baby's parents who are like clapping and urging him on when he's taking a few steps, that serves as positive reinforcement for the baby to learn. So the key thing here to note is that you're not explicitly programming the agent how to do anything, or you're not telling the agent what to do. You're defining some kind of arbitrary reward, and the agent is automatically figuring out the best actions to take. So, yeah. Quick exercise. How would you model stock trading as a reinforcement learning problem? So, in order to model anything as a reinforcement learning problem, first you have to decide what is the state, action, and the reward. So, for stock trading, the state can be just the raw stock values of the stock you want to sell or buy. So, you can also, and we did that this at Godly, we incorporated news into the state. So, we did sentiment analysis on all the news articles which mentioned the stock and incorporated that into the state. Right? What kind of actions can you take? Yeah, exactly. Buy by some amount, hold, or sell by some amount. What kind of reward do you want to set? So yeah, so you want this agent to make a profit. So you'll reward the agent whenever it does. You'll set the net reward, a net profit as the reward. So RL is being used in many domains, and this is not an exhaustive list, and I'm not going to cover these domains. If you want to find out how RL is used in these domains, you can just do a simple Google search and you can get a lot of articles and research papers. I'll just cover two of them. So Google has a lot of data centers, okay, and it has a bunch of computers and it needs to handle a lot of variable loads. Okay, so it needs a very sophisticated mechanism to direct its power to each of these computers. So Google uses RL to optimize its cooling systems, and that by doing that, they manage to bring the bill cooling cost down by 40%. And similarly, RL is used in healthcare to treat patients with a condition called epilepsy. So using RL, you can deliver a controlled sequence of shocks to the patient's brain in order to treat them. So it's not just all theory. It's currently being used to solve complex real-life problems. So very quickly, we'll jump into the mathematics behind reinforcement learning. So RL is modeled as something called a Markov decision process, okay, or an MDP. An MDP has a sequence of states, or a list of states. These are the observations that the agent can make about the environment. Okay, so here I have just highlighted three states. An MDP also has some actions which allow the agent to travel between these states. So here I have taken two actions. You can call them, you can see the blue action and the red action. So if you see the blue action from state S1, the blue action can either take it back to state S1 or it can make it go to state 2. So this is to model the stochasticity or randomness that happens in real life. So for example, you go and you ask someone out. So they might say yes or they might refuse you. But the state you end up in is not fixed in the beginning. Rather, it's a probability distribution over the states. Okay, and this is encoded by something called the transition probability function. So you can read this MDP as from state S1. If you take the blue action with a 0.1 probability, you go back to state S1. Or with the 0.9 probability, you go to state S2. Okay. So finally, you have these rewards which are associated with each state. So as you can see, state 0 has a reward of 1, state 1, 0, and state 2, minus 1, right? So ideally, you would want to take actions that let this agent stay in state 0 as much as possible. So now, we have this MDB formulation. What do we do with it? The goal is to learn something called a policy, okay? A policy basically says that if you are in this state, you perform this action. So, and this policy should satisfy some criteria for optimal behavior. And this criteria is to maximize the expected long-term reward. So, please don't worry about that equation right now. All you need to know is that we want to maximize the rewards we can get in the future. So, for example, just turn your attention to state S2. If you take the blue action from state S2, with a probability of 1, you go back to state S0 and get that reward of 1. Okay, and with a probability, and if you take the red action, you might go back to state S2 with a probability of 0.8 and get a negative reward. So the action which is maximizing the expected long-term reward is actually the blue action here. So we want to find a policy which gets us better rewards in the future. Yeah. So the good news is that for an MDP, an optimal policy or a policy which maximizes this quantity always exists. So in the real world, we don't have the agent which is in this environment. It doesn't have access to this MDP. So I have kind of grayed it out. The only thing the agent knows is that I'm in this state and I can take these actions. So the goal of this agent is to collect some form of experience from this environment. So typically what happens is that the agent says that I'm in this state, I'm taking this action. The environment takes that action, simulates it internally, and returns the next state and the reward back to the agent. So this four tuple of state, action, next state, and reward is called the experience, which is gained by the agent. So the task of the agent is to collect more and more experience and somehow find out this optimal policy. Okay, so there are many ways to do this. I'll just very briefly cover one of the most popular algorithms you can use to do this. It's called Q-learning. And again, please don't worry about this equation. In Q-learning, we estimate something called the action value function, or this QSA function. Okay, this QSA function basically tells you the expected long-term reward or utility or the goodness of being in a certain state and taking the action. So this function basically tells you how good it is to take an action from a certain state. So in Q-learning, we initialize this function randomly. So what this table essentially tells you that the blue action is slightly better than the red action. Okay. Now, the task of this agent is, again, to collect some experience. But right now, it's using this table to collect the experience. So, suppose the agent is at state S0. It will consult this table to check which is the optimal action. So right now, from state S0, the optimal action is the blue action. So it will take the blue action. It will get some next state and reward. And then it will update some equation, which you don't need to worry about right now. But this equation gives us a better estimate of being in that state and the expected utility of being in that state and taking that action. So we initialized with some random values. Now we had an updated value by collecting some experience. And you do this over time, you end up with a table like this. So after 1,000 iterations, then this table will tell you that this blue action at state S0 is good, similarly the red action at state S1 is good, and the blue action again at state S2 is good, right? So through the interaction with the environment, we have come up with the optimal policy. And it is actually, the optimal actions are represented by the dashed lines in this diagram. Another piece of very good news, Q-learning always converges to the optimal policy. So we have any arbitrary reinforcement learning problem which is modeled like this, you can apply Q learning to get the optimal policy. It is subject to some terms and conditions, and one important condition is that make sure you explore for from time to time. So that means that sometimes you want to take a suboptimal action. So this is to ensure that the agent does not get stuck in a loop and all the states are predicted. Okay. So very quick recap. We have this environment which is modeled as an MDP. We have an RL agent which is interacting with this environment with the goal of having through trial and error finding an optimal policy. This can be done by an algorithm called Q-learning. So now there's a huge glaring problem with this formulation, right? In the real world, we don't get these very nice discrete state and action spaces, right? So think of a driverless car. It has a lot of sensors embedded into it, right? And the state of the driverless car will be the sensor readings at any time t. So that is a continuous state. Similarly, the action for a driverless car will be rotate the steering wheel by this amount. So action space is also continuous. Similarly, coming back to our acrobatic agent, the state is actually some n-dimensional vector containing the joints, angles, velocities and positions of the agent. Okay, and the action is this m-dimensional vector containing the torque or the force you need to apply to each of the joints. So we need to adapt this Q-learning algorithm to handle these real-world use cases. And the idea is very simple. Q represent our Q-table as a neural network. So this neural network will take the now continuous state. So earlier there were these discrete states. Now it is a vector of real values as input, and it will output a Q value for each action. Okay. Earlier, to get the best action for each state, we were consulting the table. So right now, we are going to consult this neural network to get the best action for each state. Yeah. So how the loss function changes, I'm not going to cover this. So we handle continuous state spaces. Okay. What do we need to do if we need to handle continuous action spaces? So earlier, we had one neuron per action, representing the Q value for that action. Okay. If the action space is continuous now, in theory, we need an infinite amount of neurons to represent it. Okay. So what we do is have two neural networks. One neural network takes the state of the agent as input and outputs an action. Another neural network takes this outputted state, takes the outputted action and the state as input and outputs the Q value. So this kind of architecture is commonly known as an actor-critic architecture, where you have an actor which takes the state as input and outputs an action, and the critic tells the actor how good its action was. And the training is set up in such a way that over time, using this feedback from the critic, the actor takes better and better actions. Okay, so lot of information to take in. The great thing about using a neural network to approximate your Q function is that now you can harness the full flexibility and power of deep learning architectures in your reinforcement learning. So for example, the state that your agent senses, if it's some kind of image or video, you know that there is this architecture called a CNN that works really well with images and video. So you can use a CNN now to approximate your Q function. So really what I did in the last 10 minutes is summarize a decade of research into a few slides. So in a nutshell, deep RL can be used to solve extremely complex problems like Go and Dota 2. And I'm not going to go into them, but you can read about them. Deep RL algorithms are very hard to converge and they require a lot of hardware. and they rely on some tricks to get the neural network to converge. So there are like 100 small different things I'm not telling you. So if you really need to go deep into the technical implementation, you can check out our link. The slides will be uploaded. So just give us a couple of days to add some helpful comments to this. Okay. Now, switching to a separate topic and why we are doing this will make sense in a while. How do we as humans learn? So a majority part of our learning is done by imitating others, and we often do this subconsciously. So a large part of our attitudes, language and behavior and skills is shaped this way. So the question is, can our aural agents learn through imitation? And actually the answer is yes. This was a self-driving car which was taught how to drive by using imitation learning. So it copied the moves of a human driver. But the cool thing about this is, by the way, ALVIN stands for Autonomous Land Vehicle in a Neural Network. So the cool thing about this is, this was done in the 1980s. So the research has been going on since then. So there's an entire field dedicated to teaching agents how to learn, and it's called imitation learning, where we have some expert, and this expert can be some data, or it can be a human, or it can also be a YouTube video in our case, which is teaching the RL agent what to do. So the question is, why would we need someone to teach an RL agent what to do when it's already doing so well on its own? So to use as a motivating example, initially the RL agent is completely random. So we initialize the queue table randomly. So as soon as it explores and gets to that first reward, it starts learning. But the problem is, what if it never gets to that first reward? So imagine you have to train a self-driving car to go from Bangalore to Delhi, and you give it a plus one reward every time it reaches there safely. So through random exploration, how many tries do you think it will take? So it can be infinite, right? So in cases like these are domains with sparse rewards. You use imitation learning so that the agent is not random in the beginning, but has some good policy, and then you can use reinforcement learning to improve upon that policy. And one way to do this is through modifying the reward function. So you can give this agent a reward for driving well, for staying in the middle of the road, not hitting anyone, driving under the speed limit. But there is no guarantee that this agent will actually learn to drive by following that reward function. Okay, it's just way simpler just to demonstrate to the agent what to do. So there are again many different ways to do this, and I'm going to leave you with two very simple ideas. One, you ask our expert for some supervised samples, which basically say that if you were in this state, what action would you take? Right? You take these samples and you train your actor network in a fully supervised setting. So initially the actor network was random. Now it has some good policy, and now you can use RL to improve upon that policy. And the second way is a method called auxiliary rewards. So what you do is, along with the normal reward the agent is getting, give it an extra reward if it is doing exactly what the human is doing, or you can also penalize it for not doing exactly what the human is doing. So yeah, that hopefully brings me to an end to a lot of technical detail. The conclusion for all of this is, now you know that our acrobatic agent uses an actor-critic network, which is a kind of deep RL architecture, and it is trained using imitation learning with auxiliary rewards. Right. So this brings an end to my portion of the talk. Shiv will take it from here. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thanks, Samiran. Well, so far we have seen what is reinforcement learning, then how to formulate a reinforcement learning problem as a Markov decision process. Then we have looked at how to learn optimal policy using Q-learning, and the last thing he had talked about is imitation learning. That's the most important part we are going to convert from his slides. Okay, so in the imitation learning, what you have seen, RL agent is learning a policy which can mimic a given demonstration, and it works in a mode of an actor-critic architecture given an auxiliary rewards. Now, I don't know if you have noticed what kind of input is given to an agent during the training time. It's nothing but a sequence of states and actions. Now, as Samiran had already mentioned, here state means the joint angle, velocity and position, and accordingly the actions means the amount of torque you are providing to each and every individual joints. Okay. Now let's have a look at how to collect this kind of data set. So one of the way to collect data set is called teleoperation, where a human being is performing some actions and the same is being propagated into a robot or a simulated character, and with help of some sensory devices and all. And what you record is the state and actions of the simulated character, and that you give as an input to the RL agent during the training time. Another way to collect a similar kind of data set is called motion capture. In that case, what we do, as a human being, we perform some action, and those actions are recorded in an environment where you have green screen, lot of cameras from several viewpoints, and actor has a lot of those spatial markers as presented there in white dots, and with help of these markers it creates a 3D structure of what the human being is doing, and that's given as an input to your RL agent. Now the problem is it's extremely difficult to build such kind of environment. It requires a lot of machinery, is very expensive, going to consume a lot of time. And another difficulty is there is very less number of experts who can do this kind of setup. Okay, and yeah, and if, as you are talking about acrobatic task, so as a researcher, someone like me has to do a backflip. I mean, that's not going to work, right? But if you search for backflip in YouTube, you will see plenty of videos where some expert had already done that, recorded those videos and uploaded in YouTube. So you'll see videos where some expert is teaching you backflip in 5 steps, then comes teaching in 5 minutes, then complete everything in 5 minutes, okay, and there comes some prank where a grandpa is doing backflip and few more variation. And then comes the father of all backflip, the Indian version of doing that, okay. And the last thing you can expect, a robot is also doing a backflip. So the point I'm trying to make here is, like, you search for any random task in YouTube, you will see plenty of videos with all sort of varieties. And the idea is, how do you leverage such existing resource of huge corpus of freely available video resources to train your agent? So in general, what you are expecting, it's already been discussed by Samiran. Given a video as an input, you want the agent to learn a policy which can learn what is being demonstrated in the video. Okay. Now remember, it's not a one-to-one frame-by-frame transformation from your video to the RL agent. Even if you throw a lot of blocks to the agent, still it would be able to finish his task. Okay, so it's that kind of dynamic nature of learning. The behavior also can be retargeted to a different kind of characters, having different body shape, having different body weights. As you see here, it's doing really well on the Boston Dynamics virtual characters. Okay. Cool. Now the question is, how do you train this kind of system? What kind of modeling will you use? As Samiran had already talked about imitation learning, and that works really well to mimic a given demonstration. So imitation learning can be used as a solution to solve this problem. Now to do that, all that we have to figure out is, what will be the state space, what will be the action space, what kind of auxiliary reward you have to use, and you have to take up another problem is called domain gap. So for this framework, at one side you have a video, which is a sequence of RGB images, but on the other side, what the RL agent understands is the state and actions. Now the state is represented by, as we told you earlier, is represented by joint angle, velocity and the position. So somehow through some mechanism, you have to convert the state in the video to some kind of state what the RL agent understands. Okay. And this method is called domain gap alignment. Okay, next we will see how to do that. You have a video, you give that video to a pose estimator, and what it does for each frame, it predicts a 3D body structure of the human being. Okay, so at this stage, it's a frame by frame computation, so each frame comes with some amount of inaccuracy, and because of that, you see there is a, I mean, annoying flickering effect. Then the sequence of 3D structures are given to a module called motion reconstruction. So motion reconstruction provides a smoothness to your video, and accordingly it provides some temporal consistency. So all of these are done to solve the problem of domain gap, and this process is called domain gap alignment. So now what do we have from our input, which was video earlier, now we have the same thing in different domain which the RL agent understand, and now it could be ready to use for the imitation learning. Okay, all of you must be thinking how this pose estimator works. Okay, it's a supervised model, and the kind of training that is being used is like, one side you have 2D image of human in different poses, and for all of those images you have 2D and 3D annotation for those. Okay, so what you are trying to do is like, every pose of a human being is represented by 23 joints. So each of these white dots are the joints. So when I'm doing this versus that, the joint is here having a different position and velocity and angles. Okay, so in general, every pose of a human being can be represented by a d-dimensional vector representation. And next we'll see how to learn a model to predict this kind of representation. So the framework has an encoder and a discriminator. The encoder predicts this d-dimensional representation given a 2D image. Okay, and what the discriminator does, given those d-dimensional representation, it will say whether it looks like a human being or not. Okay, so the way the encoder works, you have a 2D image, it's given to an image encoder, the trained on a ResNet architecture, and this encoder gives you a latent space representation of the 2D image. And given the latent space representation to a 3D regression module, it's called SMPL, you predict this d-dimensional representation of your 3D character. So SMPL, which is skin-tight multi-person linear model, I'm not going into details of that. I mean, that will be too much of details for this talk. But SMPL you can consider as a module. Given a latent space of a 2D representation, you can predict all of these parameters related to the 3D model. Okay. Now, the difficult part is like, some of those parameters predicted by this encoder doesn't look like a human being. So as an example, human being cannot have a 360-degree rotation of his head position. Okay, but some of these parameters predicted by the encoder might looks like, if you render those, it looks like the head is flipped towards other side. Okay, so given this kind of predicted values to the discriminator, it should reject this kind of values and say that, okay, it doesn't look like a human being, but it looks like a monster, right? So the kind of discriminator we have is a binary classifier, which is trained on some input data having poses from different people, and given a parameter, it tells whether it's a human being or not. And this training happens in an adversarial manner. People who have understanding of how GAN works, it's almost similar to that. Well, I'm not going into the details of the optimization function, but what you should take away from here is like, there is one cost function which is being minimized with respect to E. So E is the encoder function. And there is another cost function is being minimized with respect to D. Another thing you should notice is not D but DI. So DI represents the discriminator for ith joint. So as there are 23 joints, there will be 23 independent discriminator trained separately. Okay, cool. Next, I have some results on how does this 3D prediction works, and don't judge the characters by their performance. Okay, so my good friend Samiran is trying to do flaws and see how the 3D prediction works on those. Okay, well. And then me trying to run Gangnam Style, and the kind of visualization is has in terms of these joint angles. Okay, and as you can see, for every poses, each joint has a different position and velocity and angles and so on. Okay, and then some famous steps. Cool, and then some random actions. Okay. Cool. So far what we have achieved is, we have solved the problem of domain gap alignment. So we have transformed the input from video domain to a domain which can be understood by the agent. And next what you have to do is the imitation learning. Now initially the kind of policy you have, it doesn't know how to do a particular task, so it just takes some random actions. As you see, it's just falling down on the ground. And then with help of imitation learning, so this agent takes the reference motion as an input, go for the imitation learning, and then the policy learned how to do the particular task demonstrated in the given video. Well, so the most important thing that we have to figure out is how the reward looks like. As I told you earlier, the state of a agent is represented by pose, velocity, end effector, center mass, all of those. The agent gets a reward only if it follows the given trajectory in the reference motion. Okay, if it doesn't follow it, it doesn't get any reward. So it tries to copy what is being shown in the reference motion. So the final reward is a weighted combination of each of these individual four sub rewards. Cool. There is one more difficulty. Now the question is, how does an agent will know that doing a full rotation in the midair will result into a successful backflip? Okay. So most of the RL agent works through a retrospective system. So they do some random exploration, and if they see that this particular state is resulting into high reward, they go for that. Okay. Now to give this RL agent a hints of doing a full rotation in the midair, so we'll initialize the RL agent for each episode to a random state. So sometimes it starts from the ground, or sometimes it starts in the mid of a flip kind of. Okay. So this process is called adaptive initial state, and it helps the agent to learn very complex tasks. Well, I'm switching the topic in a sense, like we told that SMPL is used to predict the three-dimensional parameters and all. Now SMPL is trained on a fixed set of input data set. Okay. Now the kind of input you have might be completely different, or might be very skewed from the kind of input is being tutored in the SMPL. So there you can have some different kind of poses and all. So at a very high level, if you look at the kind of learning we have till today, so you can go for a traditional learning where you annotate each and every data points you have, or you go for active learning where rather than annotating everything, you just go select some representative and just annotate those. I'm not going to details of the other things, but another way to go for some kind of supervision is called self supervision, where you don't tag the data explicitly, but the data itself provides the supervision. To give you an example, a very naive example, in a sense, you have some images. Now you want to build a classifier which will classify given an image, how much is the rotation of the image, whether it's a 0 degree, 90 degree, 180 or 270 kind of. So you take an image without any rotation, you through some mechanism you rotate that with 90 degree, and that becomes your input data set for 90 degree rotated images and so on. Now in our context, how to introduce the self supervision, you take some image at times t1 and take another image at time t2. So at some point of time here, then at time 2 I've just moved by some distance. Okay. So for both of these, you predict the 3D parameter. So all of these are those d-dimensional representation. Now, in the 3D prediction, the kind of distance you have between the movement, it should match with the kind of distance you have on the segmented foreground images. Okay. Now, to detect the kind of movement it has in the 2D segmentation, optical flow is being used. So through this feedback loop, you can fine-tune the predicted parameter predicted by SMPL. Okay, I'm done with the technical part of our conversation. Let me show you a few more results. So the agent is so robust that even if you throw a block targeting to the head of this agent, still you would be able to finish his task successfully. Okay. Even you put this agent in an extremely difficult environment, having a lot of ups and downs, having uneven surface and all, still you would be able to finish his task. And you can also increase the complexity of the environment, saying there are disjoint surfaces. Look how he's trying to adjust to those disjoint surfaces and all. And eventually, when almost there is no way to adjust, it's going to fall down. Fine. So this learning not only can be done on a simulated character, but the same can also be transferred to a physical robot, definitely in future. Okay. So I'm just showing an example of Boston Dynamics robots, but this kind of learning through YouTube videos can be propagated to a physical robots like this. And as research make more progress in this domain, very soon what you can expect in future is something like this. But the robot is taking care of your cooking. So all that you have to decide that on a particular day, what do you want to eat? Right, and this learning can be done through a demonstration of lot of videos where the human is doing or human is cooking a recipe. It was a prototype proposed by Mole Robotics. And the robot not only does the cooking for you, it also does the cleaning afterward. Cool. Well, we are done with our presentation. We'll open the dais for any question. Questions?
Any questions?
Right.
During the learning, the states can get added also, right? Suppose for a self-driving car, so it was first getting self-driven, say suppose in a city, then it went to a desert. So as it encounters new scenarios or new situations, it will take those scenarios as a part of its states?
Right. Yeah. So what you're seeing as an input, you have a video. So each video has a state. Okay. Now, as you are saying, you have a demonstration which is not being seen earlier. If it mimics the kind of states you had earlier in your state space, then it will definitely be propagated in the kind of learning you have.
So that means if this particular car is now hitting the desert, then I have to give the video of the desert to.
So,
suppose like I'm telling you a very like common scenario. Say suppose the car, my car is traveling. Okay, it's a self-driven car. So it starts traveling from Bangalore and it is going towards, say suppose it's going towards Bengal. Okay. Now I encounter a village suddenly because you have to cross so many villages in the highway. So like earlier it was like the city roads, then it became a highway. But suddenly I go to a village and I have not prepared that model with the pictures of a village road. So is that
Yeah.
So this agent only knows one state. So okay, it will only know one picture of suppose it was trained in a highway. Okay, and suppose it was already trained in a highway, it will start driving very well. But suddenly if it encounters a desert, it will have no idea what to do. It will have some kind of prior from driving in the highway, but it will need time to adjust itself. It will need more cycles of learning. Okay.
Okay.
Not a good job, but eventually.
Okay. So this part, this. Yeah, sure.
Hey, any question from this?
Just a couple of questions. Great presentation. First, how you are basically using these models on your work front end? How in your company or otherwise, just want to understand your practical application in your context and. The second is like obviously the 99.5% industry is not into robotics. I mean, of the work that we do to the both. So what are the types of inspirations or I mean what exactly this model, but what are the parts of this model we can kind of use other fields kind of working for now?
Yeah. Right. So first part of your question, how to deploy this model in mode of a production system. So after doing the learning, what you get is a policy, an optimal policy which is learned through your learning. And if you have experience of learning in or training any neural network, you get the model and then you use that during the inference time. Similarly, the policy is what you have already learned and then that it can be used during the prediction time. Okay, so it's analogous to the way you do learning for a neural network and the kind of model you keep during the prediction is almost similar to that. Now, coming to the question of accuracy, I mean, having a 99% accuracy or very high accuracy, I would say sometimes it's possible, sometimes no, based on the kind of environment you have during the prediction time. If the environment given during prediction time analogous to the kind of environment seen during the training time, it will do really well.
Like probably you got the question of the other side, 99.5%. Things that we probably already could not kind of cover robotics.
Right.
And these kind of applications. So is it like all these models then typically relevant to only kind of robotic applications, or you can take some of these applications or models and also other kind of things, because I think RL has other applications like multi-compartment models and all those kind of stuff. So what are the kind of other things that you can apply these techniques in?
So I'll answer that question. So in your we have used this for two things. One is the stock, to predict stock prices, and you can guess how that is modeled. And the second is through an intelligent way to annotate our data automatically, which mimics the search process of a human. So if a human is like going through some process while tagging the data, we can use reinforcement learning to mimic that process. Now, apart from your, if you have any kind of control system that you want to optimize, like you want to control an elevator or some kind of traffic light in a highway, where the environment is very dynamic, right? You can use reinforcement learning. And the third most common use case in the industry is in recommendation engines. So especially ad recommendations and layout recommendations, since you mentioned multi-armed bandit. So I guess I'm not going to cover it. Yeah, does that answer your question? Thank you.